Hi guys, this is GKCS. We are talking about dynamic programming today. So what I wanted to talk about first is a state machine. Now in computer science, what happens is very often you are representing different states that you have. So states are a set of variables having different values. Different states as a node. And from those states, you can move to another node. Okay, another state basically. And so on and so forth till you reach the desired state that you want. So let's say 11 is the place we want to go to. So how do you find out the value at 11? Well, three values will come in, 6, 7, and 8. And similarly, they will be built using the values over here. Now, if you take this entire graph, you can represent your problem. But there's a more concise way to do that using some math. So if you focus on this, what you'll see is that at a state x with index x, you can get there using some function, taking three parameters, which is x minus 3, x minus 4, and x minus 5. So these three states as parameters to this function, which we don't know about, is going to give you this new state. So what you have is recursion, because you have problems of one type, and you're breaking into problems of the same type. Okay, I'm careful enough to say that I'm not breaking it into smaller problems, because that would be divide and conquer. Recursion does not always have to be converging. It could be diverging. It could be getting into bigger problems, and you won't be able to solve it, but that's fine. At least the problem is recursive. That much is known. What happens now is that you want to save these states instead of computing them again and again and again. For example, at 11, you want 6, 7, and 8 to be computed. So what you do is you go to 6 and you say 1, 2, and 3 have to be computed. Okay, that makes sense because we haven't actually computed them earlier. But look at 7. When 6 was computed and it returned, you go to 7 and you say that I need to compute 2, 3, and 4. But over here, 2 and 3 were already computed when you were computing for 6. So this is some extra information that you had. When you're computing 7, you need these guys, 2, 3, and 4. So essentially, you could have used this part. If we can do this, then we are saving some time to compute the new value. And similarly, at 8, what's going to happen is you need these three guys. These two are already computed. And so you can reuse that information. So what we are trying to do is reuse information. That's the very first property of dynamic programming, apart from being recursive. So this is an obvious part, and recursive, you know, with no cycles in them. Otherwise, I don't know how you're going to solve this problem, but recursive with cycles is also, I don't think, very solvable. But first property, which is called overlapping subproblems, basically means that when you use dynamic programming, there should be some benefit. That's what it means. The benefit is like these two nodes being already calculated or something. Okay. Overlapping subproblems, meaning whatever problems that you break into from the parent should have some part overlapping with the previous parent, with the previous node, or with some other node that you calculated previously. So there is some sort of already computed part. That's what overlapping subproblems are. The second property is optimal substructure. So again, two really big words. Optimal substructure. So what does it mean? It means that if you're at problem state X, then the problems that you need to solve to get here are smaller than the state X itself. Okay, you're going to be going for smaller and smaller subproblems. So something like divide and conquer in a way. You break the problems into subproblems and individually solve those. Once you're done, you have the current problem also solved. So that's exactly what optimal substructure means. Now, these two properties define what a dynamic programming problem is. Okay, if you can do these two things for that problem, and of course if it is recursive, otherwise these things won't even come in, then you can say that yes, with guarantee I can do dynamic programming on this problem to solve it. The final thing about dynamic programming is that if you need to find out the value of a state, let's say 11, that's the answer we want, there are two ways to do this. One is to go to 11, say that we need three states. So 6, 7, and 8 need to be computed. Then we come to 1, 2, and 3 because 6 needs to be computed. Now these three are computed, right? So we store them in some sort of a map, some sort of a data structure. Now, 6 is computed, so we are done. We come to 7. 7 wants 2, 3, and 4 computed, but 2 and 3 are already done. So we save some computation there and do just 4. 7 is computed, we come to 8. 8 says 3 and 4 are already done. 5 is computed, 8 is computed, 11 is computed. So this was a top-down approach. We went from the right to the left, till we are done, and then move back to answer for this state. A similar thing can be done using a slightly different approach, which is called bottom-up approach. Okay, bottom-up, yeah. So 5 is computed first, or let's start from the top. 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5. So we are done with one layer, and you know that the next layer completely depends on this layer. So what we have done is we have just computed this 5 times without a need for a map or anything like that. These things are done. Now we want 6. All we need to do is just go at 1, 2, and 3 and compute this function to get the value at 6. Done here? Well, we need 7 now because we are still on the second layer. So 7 will be done using 2, 3, and 4, which are already computed. We don't need to worry about checking whether it's computed or not. 8, 3, 4, and 5. Guaranteed to be computed, already done. Now that this layer is done, we go to 11. We don't look at whether 6 has already been computed or not. We just say, of course it has. So 6, 7, and 8, the values are taken, and we do this. So that's the bottom-up approach, where you go from the left, layer by layer, to the rightmost, and you get the solution over here. Okay, just a intuitive understanding of what dynamic programming is. We'll, of course, get into detail in the series very soon. The next video is going to be on Fibonacci series. Like, I didn't choose Bitmask yet because I want to take this a little step by step. So that's a medium level problem. We'll be using some matrix exponentiation to find the largest Fibonacci number that we can. Not the largest, but yeah, a pretty large Fibonacci number. And if you have any doubts on this, then please feel free to leave them in the comments below. I'll be just sharing some links for dynamic programming and the preconditions that we talked about. And hopefully you'll have some fun next time. See you.